Thanks very much. Let's talk about this now with Kellyanne Conway, counselor to the president. Welcome back to GMA. So why was Jared Kushner meeting with a Russian banker?
Jared has said that he's willing to go and share whatever information he has. He actually has made that clear for many months now, and he looks forward to doing that.
Right, but there seems to be a discrepancy here. The White House saying that he was talking about Russian relations, U.S.-Russian relations. Did they discuss sanctions? The Russians are saying, no, this is private business.
And we're going to trust that. I mean, I would refer you to the comments of former acting and deputy CIA director Mike Morrell. He served under President Obama, George. He said recently that so far all he hears are media reports about what intelligence officials said, and that it's been his experience that the media often get those wrong, that they're relying upon a chain of reporting that is, not reliable. Well, Jared, he's been willing to cooperate, and he's willing to go and say what he knows. But I think there's so much speculation out there, and it's usually gone through a presumptively negative lens. Let's give him a chance to say what he knows.
And that's why I was trying to ask you, but you're not prepared to say what he was talking about right now.
No.
On the issue of James Comey, will the president invoke executive privilege, or does he want former Director Comey to testify before Congress?
Well, we'll be watching with the rest of the world when Director Comey testifies. The last time he testified under oath, the FBI had a scurry to correct that testimony. He was off by hundreds of thousands in his count, his sworn testimony count of the number of information, the number of emails that Huma Abedin allegedly sent to her husband, Anthony Weiner. He said there were hundreds of thousands. Turns out that was off by hundreds of thousands.
So the president's not going to invoke executive
privilege? The president will make that decision. But look, we also want to refer everybody to what Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein said about James Comey, because Rosenstein, as the DAG, he has direct authority over the FBI director. And he came on the job after being confirmed 94-6 in the U.S. Senate, after serving as President Obama's U.S. attorney in Maryland. And coming on the job, he went and looked at the investigation about the way Mr. Comey handled Hillary Clinton's email investigation. And he concluded that it really hurt the morale and the integrity of the department. Go and read the letter for everyone can see it. He also talked about how Mr. Comey tried to usurp the authority of the Department of Justice by supplanting Loretta Lynch, the attorney general at the time, her judgment for his. He didn't like the fact that he held a press conference.
But the president had decided to fire Comey before he got that memo from Rosenstein.
He said that he was thinking about that for a while, and that is true. He saw that testimony a few Wednesdays ago, was very unimpressed. You know how the president feels about Director Comey. And Director Comey, in his goodbye letter to his colleagues at the FBI, George, clearly said that he has long believed a president has the right to fire an FBI director for any reason or for no reason. So that is the president's right. In addition, and independent of that, his deputy attorney general, whose job it is to oversee the FBI director, had concluded much the same thing. He said that the morale and the integrity of the department had been compromised, and that one of the only thing that unites people of diverse viewpoints is their dissatisfaction with the way Mr. Comey handled the end of the Clinton email investigation.
At that time, the president also suggested he had tapes of his conversations with Mr. Comey. Does he have those tapes? Is he going to release them?
Well, I won't comment on that. When Director Comey goes to testify, I think that will be a very clarifying moment. I would again repeat that in his most recent sworn testimony, it had to be corrected almost immediately. He was off by hundreds of thousands in his projected calculation. But it's more important to have somebody testify under oath, frankly, than to have his friends and his former colleagues out there speaking to the media not under oath.
We will all be watching on Thursday. The president says he wants to renegotiate this Paris Climate Accord, but we saw the leaders of Germany, France, Italy come out. UN officials also come out and say it cannot be renegotiated. So how's the president plan to do this?
The president said many things yesterday. Most fundamentally, the president said, as he always has, George, that his first responsibility is to Americans, their interests, their jobs, and economic growth here. Why should we front load so much of the economic burden in this agreement to the detriment of the American worker? All the projections say that we would have a decline in some of the key sectors where men and women in this country rely upon for their livelihood: cement, paper, natural gas, coal. Why are we doing that and yet letting India and China get off scot-free? You know, when this was originally negotiated by President Obama,
they're not getting off scot-free. They're making commitments to reduce their emissions as well.
It's pretty unimpressive, and I would go back and look, because I have, at many of the outcry by the environmentalists when this was originally negotiated. So many of them complained that this actually would not have a statistically significant impact on carbon emission reduction, and yet China and India were not being forced or persuaded to conform their behavior. Look, this is about protecting the American worker and protecting American jobs and renegotiating a better deal.
Does the president still believe global warming is a hoax?
The president believes in a clean environment, clean air, clean water. He's received awards as a businessman in that regard. And he made very clear yesterday what he doesn't believe, which is that the U.S. government should stay in an agreement that gives us too much of the financial burden, too much risk to these industries where the coal miners, people who work in cement and paper, people who he looked in the eye in place after place, in city after city, while he was running
for... Does he believe global warming is a hoax?
He believes in clean air, clean water, a clean environment, and he believes that we have to negotiate better deals for this country and that there's a balance between environmental protection and economic growth.
I'll ask it one more time. Does he believe global warming is a hoax?
You should ask him that.
Kellyanne Conway.
And I hope you have your chance.
I do, too. Thank you for coming in. We'll have more Sunday on this.